first of all, to understand the period of time. We're talking about after the kingdom of Israel was exiled and by Assyria, and the kingdom of Judah survived. Now, the book in Melachim that you learned already is ending with the destruction of the first temple. And Yirmiya lived before the destruction of the first temple. It means that Yirmiya lived parallel to the end of the book of Melachim. And he dealing with the prophecies of the exile, the destruction of Beit HaMikdash. Therefore, the Chazal call him the prophet of the destruction. No longer a nice story. We don't want to deal with the real thing, with the exile, the destruction, the best thing ever. Okay. Now, I want to discuss a basic question. First of all, we're not going to talk about the book. We're going to learn the book, right? To learn a chapter in the book. Then, the basic question that we need to ask ourselves, and probably you met Aftarot and learning about the book of Yirmiyahu, and the question is, why did the people not prevent the exile? It's a basic question. Yirmiyahu was there. He said, look, it's going to happen. Why they didn't prevent it? But before, let's start from the beginning. The first psukim in the book of Yirmiyahu telling us about Yirmiyahu himself. First of all, he's come from a village that's called Anatot near Yerushalayim. It means probably that he was a Kohen. This was a village of Kohanim. And most of his received, his prophecies come and going to be in Yerushalayim himself. It seems that he never get married and no children, but I said like, but because I saw one of the commentaries about Yechezkel that we're going to talk later, that says that Yechezkel was the son of Yirmiya. But it's like only one commentary, but some say. And the book of Yirmiya is not organized in a chronological way, and it's very hard to divide the book, and the prophecies go and back all the time. And we're going to see it also today. Yirmiyahu predicts total about 40 years before the destruction. And after the destruction, he go to Egypt and then probably died there. It's not sure, we don't sure where he's buried to exactly. Some said in Egypt, some said like people took his body back to Israel. But at the end of the prophecy is in Mitzrayim, and this is according to what we have in the Psukim. I want to see this nevuah, this prophecy in chapter 7, and through it, to learn about more about Yirmiyahu and to understand the experience that Yirmiyahu experienced with the people in Yerushalayim. And you have the source sheets, source number one, we're going to read the Psukim, and you have the translation from most of Psukim, and let's learn. Okay. Source number one, Pasuk Aleph. הדבר אשר היה אל ירמיהו מאת השם לאמור. עמוד בשער בית השם, וקראת שם את הדבר הזה, ואמרת, שמעו דבר השם כל יהודה הבאים בשערים האלה להשתחוות להשם. So meaning, we see from here, it's not only important what Yirmiyahu going to say, it's also important the location, where exactly he's going to say. Now, Hashem commanded Yirmiyahu to stand in the gate of the temple. And to tell all the people that come in to the temple to offer a sacrifice to Hashem the following. Pasuk Gimel. Ko amar Hashem Tzevaot. Elohei Israel, hetivu darkechem umaalalchem, veshakna etchem bamakom hazeh. Al tivdechu lachem al divrei ha-sheker le'emor, heichal Hashem, heichal Hashem, heichal Hashem hema. I want to say something that this is the haftara of Parashat Tzav that we read. The Parashat Tzav dealing with the sacrifice. And I think after we're going to finish to learn here, we're going to understand why Chazal decide to match the Haftara to this Parasha. Now, let's see. He actually tell the people that come to the house of Hashem, look, you come in to the house of Hashem. You come to sacrifice the Korban. And you think that I'm here, but I'm not. So Yirmiyahu says that to the people, that you want that I will dwell with you in this temple. You want to sacrifice me sacrifices? Great. But I'm not here. What do you mean? This meaning, according to the idea of Yirmiyahu, the temple belongs to the people and to Hashem, to God. It's both of you. Like it's like together. But the people going to see and differently way how to see the temple. And according to Yirmiyahu, when the people since Hashem going to leave the temple. But for them, they're going to see and to say, Echal Hashem, Echal Hashem. What is it? Like, Echal Hashem is the temple. It's meaning to say three times, the temple, the temple, the temple. It's like to say, what is important here? Hashem or the temple? So you think that you're going with the false prophecies, with the false prophets, and to say or to think that the building is important. This is what you mean. And regardless to our action, Hashem is going to be here. The people can see, can sin and to do the evil things ever and go and sacrifice to Hashem. Like, it's okay. To worship idols and come sacrifice to Hashem and it's okay. It's like they think that the building, that the temple belongs only to Hashem. It is a different approach how to see the temple. Now, he tells them, look, you can do it too. You can try to do the right thing. But the people have a problem because the perception is wrong. The basic perception of the people is wrong. So if I'm thinking that this is the most important thing, the building itself, then what is the problem? I can do whatever I want. And still, the building is going to be there. Hashem is never going to destroy this house. Then why to do tshuva? Why? The idea that Yirmiyahu tried to tell to say to the people, look, this is the building, it belongs to both of you. If you going to do the evil in the eyes of Hashem, Hashem not going to do well in this house. They think the opposite. And he tried to convince them in two ways. The first way is in Pasuk 5. Kim heitivu tativu et arkechem ve et ma'alachem im asot ta'asu mishpat ben ish uven re'eu ger yatom ve'almana lo ta'ashku ve'dam naki al tishpechu b'makom hazeh. ואחרי אלוקים אחרים לא תלכו להרע לכם. ושיכנתי אתכם במקום הזה, בארץ אשר נתתי לעבודכם, למין העולם ועד העולם. It's meaning, you think that this is the house of Hashem because someone in the past built this house and call him Echal Hashem, call him the house of Hashem. But you're wrong. Your action going to determine if Hashem is going to be there or not. This is the basic thing. Therefore, if you going to do the evil in the eye of Hashem, Hashem going to other place. This is like the basic assumption that Yirmiyahu going to give them. But this is like the basic and like very understanding. The people, of course, like the perception is so rooted that the people have a problem to change it. And now we try to bring another approach. Before the another approach, he tried to tell them that the basic thing that you need to know is what to do before you go into sacrifice korbanot, and you can see it in Pasuk 8. הנה אתם בוטחים לכם הדברי השקר לבלתי הועיל. הגנוב, רצוח ונאוף וישבע לשקר וכתר לבעל והלוך אחרי אלוהים אחרים אשר לא ידעתם ובאתם ועמדתם לפניי בבית הזה אשר נקרא שמי עליו ואמרתם ניצלנו למען עשות כל התואבות האלה
המערת פריצים היה הבית הזה אשר נקרא שמי עליו בעיניכם. גם אנוכי הנה ראיתי נאום השם.
Yirmiyahu is the people, ask the people a rhetorical question. How you can believe in this religious perspective that you can do the evil in the eyes of Hashem and believe that the temple never going to destroy? And this is a rhetorical question. When you do the wrong thing, the evil thing in the eyes of Hashem, this place, it's no longer temple. This is Ma'arat Paritzin. This is a cave for robbers, a cave for criminals. It's not a temple. The name temple, it's by the action that you're going to do there. If you're going to do the evil in the eyes of Hashem, it's going to be something else. This building is going to be a criminal cave. Therefore, the conclusion from the idea of Yirmiyahu, it's different conclusion in the eyes of the people. It's meaning, the people think the buildings belong to Hashem. Yirmiyahu said, no, the building belong to you and Hashem. And you decide if Hashem is going to be there. This is the basic assumption. Now, Yirmiyahu tried to go another approach. We can see in Pasuk 12. Ki lo na el mekumi asher b'shilo. אשר שיקנתי שמי שם בראשונה, וראו את אשר עשיתי לו מפני רעת עמי ישראל. ואתה יען עשותכם את כל המעשים האלה נאום השם, ואדבר אליכם משכם ודבר, ולא שמעתם ויקרא אתכם ולא עניתם. ועשיתי לבית אשר נקרא שמי עליו, אשר אתם בוטחים בו, ולמקום אשר נתתי לכם לאבותיכם, כאשר עשיתי לשילו. והשלחתי אתכם מעל פניי, כאשר השלחתי את כל אחיכם, את כל זרע אפרים.
אם אני עושה את זה פיפול, without getting to the opinion, if it's true or not, you say that Hashem never going to destroy this house, it's wrong. It's wrong assumption, because look at the history. We have the tabernacle in Shiloh. What's happening in Shiloh? He said, look, if you look at Shiloh, Hashem destroyed his tabernacle, his house there, because the same thing. Then, how you can say that Hashem never going to destroy this house? Look. And why is mentioned specifically Shiloh? There's a couple of reasons. First of all, you need to understand that Shiloh exists, the tabernacle in Shiloh, Mishkan Shiloh exists 368 years. It's more than every temple. And even though Hashem, in the end, destroyed it. First of all. Second, if the Mishkan of Shiloh, Hashem destroyed because the same reason. People were sin. The Kohanim was corrupted. And I think the most important thing is the idea that the people in the time of the destruction of Shiloh think the same assumption. What is the meaning? If you're going to book Shmuel, we're not going to only mention it. The book of Shmuel telling the story that Bnei Israel, that Am Israel, lost in the war against the Philistines. And they said, okay, why to do tshuva? Why to dive into Hashem? Very simple. Let's go to the Mishkan and bring the Ark of Hashem and go against the Philistines. The assumption is that Hashem never going to agree that the Ark of Hashem going to be in the hand of the Plishtim. In the end, what's happened? They lose. And we know the story about the Ark, what's happened in the future. But Yirmiyahu wants to look the same assumption in the past. Learn the lesson. And in the end, he said, look, the same lesson you can learn also from the kingdom of Israel. Look what happened. A few years before, the kingdom of Israel was exiled again because the sin. But the people just see the temple and said, this is stronger. We cannot imagine that it's going to happen. Now let's see the psukim in 21. Kol amar Hashem tzevot Israel. עולותיכם ספו על זבחיכם ואיכלו בשר. כי לא דיברתי את אבותיכם ולא ציוויתי ביום הוציא אותם מארץ מצרים על דברי עולה וסמה. These very hard psukim. Like, literally it's mean that Hashem didn't command them to do sacrifices. The Christian take this psukim and learn from me that every prophet have his own agenda and he bring like his own things, but I think it's not true. It's very simple psukim, and I think the explanation for this psukim is that usually Rashi explained this, like you come and sacrifice korbanot. Look here, he bring the zvachim. It's never been the chatat, like the offer that we offer a sacrifice for a sin, because nobody want to redeem his sin. They bring only zebah, they bring to a sacrifice that we burn, the whole sacrifice burned to Hashem to show, look, we give everything to Hashem. But it's not true. And Rashi says, very nice idea, I think. He says, it's a waste that you sacrifice a burnt offering. It's better to offer a peace offering. At least you can eat part of the meat and will not lose all of it. It's meaning, sacrifice is not, it's not going to give nothing with you, the connection with you and Hashem. Then if you want so much to sacrifice a korban, at least sacrifice a korban that you can eat also. It's a waste of meat. And of course that, according to Rashi, Yirmiya was the cynical here and the understanding. But Yirmiya, in the next pasuk says, look, Hashem didn't command you to sacrifice korbanot when you get out from Egypt. What is the meaning? If I go to the psukim in the Torah, it's of course Hashem. We have Parashat Tzav. This is the after of Parashat Tzav. We see all the commandments of the korbanot. And we have in source number two, we have it, Shmuel David Lutzato. And he says, we don't have the translation, I'm going to translate it. And he says the following. He says, Hashem saying to the people, Hashem saying, I'm not the, like the other gods that need a sacrifice for themselves. I command the people for sacrifice, to offer a sacrifice for themselves. What is the meaning? It's meaning from the beginning, when you went out from Egypt, I command you, the Ten Commandments, and then also a mitzvot to do with you and your friends to fix society, etc. And only then, says Shmuel David Lutzato, Shaddad, and only then I told you to build a temple and to sacrifice korbanot. We can understand from here, yeah, that maybe, I think for sure, we have two levels when we want to connect to Hashem. The first level is the Ten Commandments, like exactly like the history of the Chumash, exactly like the Torah that Hashem, we receive the Torah. The first thing, the Ten Commandments. We have a lot of judgment about between us and the society, how to handle the society, how to behave. And only then, if we fulfill it, we can go to the above level. And if we don't fulfill it, say, Yirmiyahu, why to do it? Your sacrifice is waste. Well, don't sacrifice. Don't give this sacrifice. And I think here, Yirmiyahu, tell them, look, check yourself before you come into the temple. Again, he's standing in the gate of the temple and say to the people, like, the mamash with the sacrifice, come to the sacrifice, to offer a korban to Hashem. Said, go home. Go, do tshuva, and then think about your evil action, and then come back. Now, this is the prophecy himself. We don't have a lot of time, but let's see what is the frame, the frame story of this story, and how the people react. And you can see it in source number 3. We have like the psukim in chapter 26, and we said like, we don't have an order in the book himself. And he says here the following. He said, Bereshit malchut Yehoyakim ben Yehoshiyahu melech Yehuda. Ya davar hazeh met Hashem lemor. Ko amar Hashem, emot bechatzar bet Hashem, vedaber el kol ha'arim. We see here we're going to to go to another source. But we see here, it's the same thing, the same prophet, the same idea that in the same prophecy that we learned until now. And then what's happened? In Pasuk 7, Vayishmeu ha-Kohanim va-Nevi'im. Everybody hear the prophecy. And then, Pasuk 8, Vayi kichlot Yirmiya, when he finished the prophecy, they grab him, v'chol ha'am omer, mot tamut, and they want to kill him. Why? Madu ani beta v'shem Hashem le'amor, k'shilo yi ha'bayit hazeh, v'ayir hazot echarev, me'en yoshev, v'ka'al ha'am v'el Yirmiya. Meaning, people don't understand. If this is against our religion beliefs, it's meaning that you are a false prophet. Very simple. We believe that this building going to be ever, ever, ever. You said no. If you're not going to do tshuva, this building going to be destroyed by Hashem. You think that Hashem going to destroy his house? Ah, you're probably a false prophet. This is the idea of the people. This is like the frame of the story. And then the judges come in Pasuk 10. וישמעו שרי יהודה את הדברים האלה ויעלו מבית מלך השם וישבו בטח שער השם החדש ואמרו הקונים הלוויים אל השרים וכל העם משפט מוות. He said, okay, we need to kill him. He said, okay, let's see exactly what is your claim. ויאמר ירמיהו אל כל השרים ואל העניים שלחני להינבא לבית הזה ואל העיר הזאת את כל הדברים אשר שמעתי ואתם היטיבו דרככם מעליכם. ירמיהו said to the people, look, you can kill me if you want. I don't have nothing to do. But only now. First of all, you're killing me for nothing. I'm the man of the God, and I tell you the truth. And also, if you want to hear me, you have still a chance to do tshuva. People hear it, say, ah, we have a chance. Okay. Maybe he's right. And we can see after it that the people and the judgment and the sarim and the ministers believe him. The false prophet as well, of course, says it's not true. But the people believe him. It's not mean that he's going to do tshuva. But they believe him. This is true. And then some people come and say, look, we have a tradition from the past. We have in Pasuk 18 that a guy in the name of Micha, you know Micha, the prophet, that he also prophesied about the destruction of Beit HaMikdash in the day of Chizkiyahu, the king of the king, and he did tshuva, and everything was perfect. It means that it's true. The destruction going to come. Now, after we hear it and understand the people, we know the end. The end was the people, although they believed to Yirmiyahu maybe, but still the religious perspective of the people that the temple of Hashem can be destroyed, nobody believed it. And in the end, they still do the wrong thing in the eyes of Hashem. I think what's happened here, the question is so obvious, like why they didn't redeem the sin. It's like so basic. I think the answer is very simple. When you believe inside you in the wrong way, nobody going to convince you otherwise. Thank you very much. Now we're going to do Yechezkel. Awesome, nice story about exile.
We never read the Torah sub maybe once every 10 years.
Okay.
We don't like it.
No, but now we remember, now we understand why the Chazal said, look, if you think that you're going to read about the Kabbalah, that this is the important thing, wrong. Now we go to the book of Yechezkel. Okay. Yechezkel. Again, I hope to learn a little bit inside the psukim himself and not only about it. Okay. In Yechezkel, we have a problem. We don't have a lot of information about Yechezkel himself. Now, the first pasuk of the book already starts with the describe of one of, we need more sources. The first pasuk in the book starts with the describing of the first prophecy. See, nobody come to give that like introduction. Yechezkel was the son of, etc., etc. He was a kohen also. Chazal didn't show exactly who was Buzi, Yechezkel ben Buzi. But he was a priest also, a Kohen also. And Yechezkel also lived the period before the destruction of the first temple. Therefore, as he said in Yirmiyahu, he is parallel to Yirmiyahu and to the end of the book of Melachim. If we're going to look in the book of Yirmiyahu, of Yechezkel, it's very hard to see. But Yechezkel lived the same period, but in different way, in different place, sorry. And he lived already in the exile. It's in Yechezkel, all these prophecies, is not in Yerushalayim. It's in the Babylon. When we talking about exile to Babylon, we usually said the exile to Babylon, but it's not true. We have a few levels for the exile. And the first level is the level of Galut Yehoyachin. When the kingdom of Judah rebelled in Babylon, and then Babylon sent the army, and after 3 months of siege, the king of Yehoyachin was surrounded, and Babylon exiled the people, the government, Yehoyachin himself, and all the people usually that Baalei HaMelacha, craftsmen, that usually may be going to produce a weapon, etc. And with them, Yechezkel, going to exile. So what we're going to read in Yechezkel happened in Babylon is very important to understand it. Now, the prophecy of Yechezkel is really different from the other prophecies when you see. And first of all, it's a very impressive sight that we see. We see the charity, we see other side, very like the beginning of the book, the first time that we see in the Tanach, electricity, chashmal. Like, it was like, it's very hard to understand. Even Chazal said that the people thought that we need to put in the side the book of Yechezkel because like, people don't understand it, and other problems that we have in the book, but in the end we have the book with us. In contrast to the other prophecies as Yirmiyahu, that dealing with the prophecies of the destruction and the exile, Yechezkel is already in the exile. Therefore, have different challenge with the people. He cannot threat and said, look, if you're going to see the evil in the eyes of Hashem, I'm going to send you to exile. Oh, good morning, iPhone. I'm in the exile already, thank you. It's mean like you need to change your approach to the people. And it's very important to understand it. And we're going to see it in chapter 18 to learn and more about the challenge. And this question is a very famous question that we're dealing with. And this is the question of the reward and the punishment. How Hashem ruling, or how Hashem handling, or other things like the world, like how exactly the punishment, the reward work in this world. And let's see the first pasuk in chapter 18. Vayidvar Hashem elai le'emor. Ma lachem atem moshlim hamashal hazeh, this allegory, al admat Yisrael le'emor. Avot yochlu boser v'shineh banim tikena. He says it about Admat Israel. There will be a big discussion exactly that sometimes Yechezkel send prophecies to the land of Israel, and we can see in the book of Yirmiya also the letters that he gets from Babylon. But Yechezkel, of course, he himself in Babylon. And he doesn't look. Avot achlu boser v'shinei banim tikhena. That your father, our father was sin, and we pain for these sins. Now, they think that they send to the exile because the father. We can see it also mentioned in the book of Yirmiyahu. It means that it is common opinion of the people. It's not like some of the people, so small group, understand it. That the people really think that they now in the exile because the father. You understand the meaning that they don't check in themselves. They look in. They need a reason, and let's understand exactly. Pasuk 3. Chai ani neum Hashem Elohim. Im yeh lachem od mashol hamashal hazeh v'Yisrael. Hen kol hanefashot li hena kenefesh ha'av v'kenefesh haben li. Hanefesh achotet hi tamut. The Yechezkel said loud and clearly, look. Don't think otherwise. Who is going to sin, going to die? Very simple. Don't think other option. And because you understand that this is, again, as we said in Yirmiyahu, this is very deep perception of the people, he now tries to bring more details and more example to convince them that this is not true. And what is the meaning exactly? Because of course, and you see in Yirmiyahu, to say one, even though it's very short and clearly thing, people said, okay, thank you, Harry. I understand, thank you very much. And he tried now to convince the people and bring three examples of what exactly he means. The first one we see in Pasuk 5. Ve'ish ki yet tzadik. ועשה משפט וצדקה על הערים ולא אכל ועיניו ולא נסע. I'm not going to read all of it, but he says, who is was a tzaddik, a righteous, will merit his reward. He is going to get his reward, period. Don't think if you are a tzaddik, you're going to get your reward. what is my father? I don't care. You, tzaddik, you're going to get reward. Very simple. And this is the first example. And he also brings a list that defines who is exactly the tzaddik. And we see why to bring this list. I think to say to people, look, if you think maybe that you're the tzaddik, here's a list. Check yourself. Maybe you apply for one of the of the things in the list. To say that you are a tzaddik. But check yourself. This is like, I think it's a message to the people. Next example, in Pasuk 10, V'holid ben parit shofech dam, V'asa ach echad melech. It's meaning, this righteous father, now we have a son, but a wicked son. V'hu et kol ele lo asa. Ki gam ele harim achal, v'et eshet re'u tima, v'et cetera, et cetera. He was good. He was a tzaddik. He was a wicked. His father was a tzaddik. He was righteous. He was a wicked. And he says, and this is like very basic, we understand it. If you're wicked, it's very simple. You're going to die because of your sin. This is very, very simple. Now the third example that we're going to read, and this is the example that exactly parallel to the claim of the people's claim. And but it's only in the end, like the third example. And we need to ask why. But first let's see the example. In Yudalit, in 14. Veina olid ben vayaret kol chatat aviv asher asa. It's meaning the father was evil and the son is righteous. Exactly as the claims that they, okay, we are okay. We are in exile, not because of us, because of father.
וירק ולא יעשה כהן אל הערים ולא אכל ועיניו לא נשא אל גילולי בית ישראל. את אשת רעהו לא טימא ואיש לא הונה, חבו לא חבל וגזלה לא גזל, לחמו ורעב לנתן, etc. etc. And in the end, 18, ואמרתם, מדוע לא נשא הבן בעוון האב? והבן משפט וצדקה עשה, את כל חוקותיו שמר ויעשה אותם, חיו יחיה, הנפש החוטאת היא תמות.
Meaning, the people don't understand. It's very odd for them. But first of all, why Yechezkel bring first the two examples, and only the third one is the example of the claim themselves? And I think it's a very simple answer. In contrast to their religious perception, Yechezkel want to change it. They think that the reward and punishment depend in the past, in the fathers, and they want to change it. Now, this is a very rooted perception. And we saw in Yirmiya, it's very hard to change a perception of people. And Yechezkel understands it. And he says, look, if I'm going to start to change this perception, people are going to say, probably you are a false prophet. Probably you are wrong. It's not true. We have more excuse to give you. Yechezkel understand it. And is it smart? And it's start from the things that it's very obvious. Everybody going to agree that if you're a tzaddik, if you're a righteous, you're going to reward as a righteous. It's very simple. We agree. We see, he's a smart. He's right. And only in the end, it comes and look, also, about your claim, you need to know. I'm going to look, Hashem, going to look only in your behavior. And then, the people steal, and you see the psukim that says, Ve'amartem madua, they don't understand how you can think about it. Now, it's a very good question. How do you can think about it? And the answer is very simple. It's not from a stranger source. It's in our Torah. Look in source number somewhere. Source number 2. Sefer Shmot. Moshe says to the people in the Ten Commandments, Hashem lo tishtachave elem elot avdo, ki anochi Hashem Elohecha el kano poked avon avot al banim ve'al shileshim ve'al riveim. We said it in Yom Kippur. It's strange. It's meaning the people learn Torah. They know the Torah. They claim things from the Torah. Then what is the problem? First of all, how Yechezkel can change it? And I think Yechezkel understand that this is very problematic, but the problem I think is the people. It's they take this claim and use it for themselves. They didn't do tshuva in the beginning. They cannot blame themselves. Of course, we are good. Now, if we are good, we need to find an explanation for the exile. Okay, let's start to find. We have the Torah that said that the father is going to be sin and the son going to be punished. This is applied to us. It's true. This is our case. Look. It's meaning the idea that we have zchut avot, that things that happen going to affect the next generation, It's still here. It's different things in different case. It's okay. The idea, or I think the question, or the problem, when and where you use it exactly. And the people here use it as excuse to take out the responsibility for themselves. It's not us. The exile is not because of us. We are good. Again, we see, as you see in Yirmiya, excuse why don't do tshuva. It's very simple. And Yechezkel understand it. And he understand that to move the people from this bad perception is going to be very hard. Therefore, he try another way. He says, look, let's try to change the perception from a collective punishment to private punishment. It's been until now, in Yirmiya also, and a lot of books, we're talking about the nation, about the people, the Am, as a one. Yechezkel understand that this is a problem. He says, okay, let's try to do like each of you going to check themselves as a person, as a private person. I don't care about the nation. And look, in Pasuk Yud Bet, V'hineh olid v'chatam avi asher asa, sorry, in chapter Yudani, in Source 3, ויהי דבר השם אליי לאמור, it's another prophecy of יחזקאל, בן אדם, ארץ כי תחתה לי למעול מעל, ונתיתי יד עליה ושברתי לה מטה לחם, והשלחתי בה רעב, והכרתי ממנה אדם ובהמה. והיו שלושת האנשים אלה. Now it's very going to be very extreme example. In the end, there are going to be three people left. Who is those three people? This is a prophecy, again. Who is those three people? Noach, Daniel, ואיוב. Three people, three righteous people going to stay. This is the story that, the example that Yechezkel gives to the people. And he says, look, and they was going to be righteous. And only they going to survive. Even the children not going to survive. It's so extreme, like from all the people, from all the nation, three people, famous people also, Noach, that Ish Tzadik Ha'ev Bedorotav. Yo! And it's so extreme to show the people, look, stop thinking as a nation. I don't care what's going to be with the nation. We all the time said the nation and how the temple of the nation. We finished the nation. Let's change the perception to private perception. What you did. This is the question. Don't tell me about the nation. Don't tell me about the land. Don't tell me about the people. Your private action. This is the going to be the question. And the source we have from the Bavli in the source number 4, this is exactly what's happened. And look at the Gemara in source number 4. ואמר רבי יוסי בר חנינא, ארבעה גזרות, four decree, השם give to משה רבנו, and משה רבנו give to the people. משה אמר, פקוד אבון אבות על בנים. And he says that the kids going to suffer because the fathers. בא יחזקאל, and then come יחזקאל, and change and cancel it. הנפש החוטאת היא תמות. And cancel the idea. So even the Gemara understand that sometimes you need to change the perception, and it's not like what is wrong and what is right. If we need to see everything as a collective or everything in the private. No. Different case, different solutions. This is the idea. If you're going to choose the same solution all the time, we're going to fail. And Yechezkel understand it. And in Pasuk, and then it says also the opposite way. In Pasuk Chaf. In Pasuk Chaf he says that it's mamash in the end of the source, it's in the first page.
בן לא יישא באבון אב, ולא יישא באבון הבן. צדקת הצדיק עליו תהיה, ואישת רשע עליו תהיה. It's mean, you need to know. It's not only that you're not going to suffer because your father, also you're not going to suffer because your son. If you think, oh, I'm righteous, I did the best thing ever, but you know, I don't have a control in my son. Yechezkel said, don't worry, I don't care. I'm going to check you. Again, it's very radical perception. But I think in this case, Yechezkel didn't have a choice. He needed to show the people a very clear message how to handle it. And like to try to end all the excuses that can give you about the collective, about the father, about the son, everything. Look, in the end of the day, I'm going to judge you today. What does it mean today? And he also brings the idea that if a person was a righteous all his life and something happened, maybe we're going to think, look, he all his life have a zchuyot, have like, look, he was worship Hashem all his life. Yechezkel said, no, I don't care. I check it today, not yesterday, not tomorrow, today. And you can see the psukim that Yechezkel tried to bring the message to the people. And in the end, I want to ask the question, Yechezkel succeed or not? And I think it's a very important question to ask. Sometimes the prophet, sometimes the leaders. And to answer this question, we need to go to chapter 3 in source number 5. And here it's very nice, I think, nice prophecy. And it says, Va'avoy la'gola Tel Aviv. You know Tel Aviv? Where is Tel Aviv? In Israel. Where is Tel Aviv here? In Babylon. It's been in the name of the city. And if you want to ask if it's like the name of Tel Aviv is from here, it's a good question. We don't want to deal with it. Only, yeah, they have a connection to here. It's very funny because like Tel Aviv, the idea of Tel Aviv is like the place that that destroyed because of the flood. This is the Tel Aviv in the past, this is the place, Tel Aviv in Babylon, this was the place that destroyed because of the flood. The why they call it Tel Aviv today, it's connected a little bit because, you know, the book of Herzl, Eitloid, was the book, but Sokolov, when he translated this book, he called it Tel Aviv. And from here, it's like he took it from this prophecy, but it's another story. Now, in chapter 3, we see a very important thing, that Hashem command Yechezkel exactly what is his duty. Now, probably, if I meet Yechezkel today and say, look, Yechezkel, you succeed in your job, you fulfill your goal in life, what is this going to be? No. I supposed to prevent maybe the destruction of the temple in Israel because I was in Babylon. But probably, my goal was to bring the redemption that he tell Am Yisrael about the redemption. And also he described the third Beit Mikdash in the future. But we know, but the ending of Yechezkel, they stay in exile. Yechezkel even understand that he have a problem. All the prophecies usually come to the people and say, okay, look, if you're not going to change, I'm going to bring the exile. But he says, we're in the exile. That I need something that going to bring the people or to push the people to do tshuva. He says, look, if I cannot use the exile, let's use the redemption. So it's like, you're already in exile? Okay, let's look for the light. Where is the light? The redemption. You want redemption? You want to stay or you want redemption? It's mean all the idea to go from the collective to the private is on you. The redemption is going to come. You need to choose.
Usually, we're choosing to be with the nation. It says, we're in a different, different situation. You need to choose. You're actually going to decide your decision. But in the end, in the eyes of Yechezkel, probably, he says, look, in the end, we stand in Babylon. This is the eyes of Yechezkel. But let's see in the eyes of Hashem. What was his goal to achieve? And we can see that he says in Pasuk 17, in source number 5, Ben Adam, Sofen et aticha lebet Yisrael. I put you as a tsofe, observer, a guard. Okay, what is your goal as a guard?
V'izharteh otam mimeni, v'amarta l'rasha mot tamut, ולא יזרתו ולא דיברתו להביא רשע מדרכו הרעה, לחיותו הוא רשע בעוונו ימות, ודמו מידך אבקש.
So look, your goal is very simple. Go to the wicked guy and tell him, look, if you do not going to do a tshuva, you're going to die. And go to the righteous and tell him, look, if you, chas v'shalom, going to do a sin, you're going to die. And if you didn't do it, and you're going to die, it's your fault. But, this is very important. Hashem said, look, but if you did it, if you went to them and tell them, look, you need to do this, and you need to do this, and if not, the result is going to be this, even though they still didn't listen to you, you're clear. You feel your goal. I mean, in the eyes of Hashem, a prophet, specifically Yechezkel, but I think it's applied to all prophecies. A prophet is not the guy that if he didn't succeed to save Am Israel, it's mean like he fell. No, a prophet is a guard, an observer in the gate of the temple, in the gate of the exile, to tell the people, Dvar Hashem, to say to the people what Hashem wants from them. Now, everyone have free choice to choose. And the prophet need to do his job. And if you did your job, you're clear. And this is the idea. So we see from here that in the eyes of Yechezkel, it seems like very bad. But in the eyes of Hashem, he fulfilled his destination. Even though we know the end of Yechezkel. Now, and I want to finish with it to understand. I think Yechezkel was different from the other prophecies. We see Yirmiya, we see Yeshaya, all the other. It's like the same idea. Like every prophet saying the same thing. You can... If you want to see the same prophecies about the destruction, you can parallel it. It's going to be the same. I know Rabbi Tuchina said that if you have two prophecies and it's the same, it's a problem. But I think in the end, yeah, people predict the destruction. Yeah, maybe a different war, but the destruction. But Yechezkel was different. And he needed to find a different way to handle the people. And to bring them a different solution to different problems. Thank you very much. Right. Now we're going to eat lunch, I think.
Not yet, right.